In a building over there is a camera that absolutely blows my mind. Is this camera capable of filming the speed of light?
Yeah.
Very high-tech stuff, guys.
The maximum speed we can do is 10 trillion frames per second.
This is the reason we came here.
Crank it up. All the way?
Yep.
All right.
I just feel like no human should ever have seen this.
We've filmed the fastest thing. We've hit our ceiling.
It's not going to be any time soon that we're going to film anything faster, so...
Not this year, maybe.
Should we just invent some stuff?
Just start making up stuff.
Yeah, this camera is like 50 trillion.
You clearly haven't seen Super Light.
It was really interesting, the setup. You can tell that so many thousands of hours of research had gone into creating that camera.
I mean, the footage is just like, you can't really tell what's happening. When you think about what's actually happening, what you're actually seeing is more impressive than the actual footage.
Yeah, it's one of those things where sort of the idea of it is way more impressive than the visual of it.
Yes,
the visual of it looks like a slightly outdated film effect.
With a picture of a bottle on it.
Yeah. I would say of all the videos we've shot, this one, while we were shooting it, I was struggling to comprehend how the camera was actually acquiring those images. And also then you've got to think about the time scale involved. Like, I can't get my head around how short a picosecond is. It's absolutely insane.
Well, nothing else happens on that sort of scale, does it? Well, as we're struggling to wrap our heads around it, I thought it'd be best to actually ask one of the people who invented the technology. We're here with Li Hong, who's one of the inventors of the camera. So do you think you could talk us through it, exactly how it works, and we can try and understand it, because I just don't get it right now.
Sure. For the first time, humans can see how a light pulse propagates in space. But before I talk about our camera, let me talk about a standard street camera. A standard street camera gives you a 1D movie that's really fast. You only allow the X dimension or horizontal dimension to pass through, but you watch a horse race through a slit. It won't be as fun.
Right.
We're so used to your smartphone cameras seeing at least the world in 2D, if not 3D.
Yeah, so it's a world you can relate to.
Exactly. And so let me talk about how our camera works. Let's say we start with this object, but before we send it to a standard street camera, we're going to route it to this digital micromirror device. We write this code, and that's an important step because that allows us later on to decode everything to generate a 2D movie. And this encoded object is routed to this street camera. Unlike the standard use of the street camera, we allow the white dimension or the vertical dimension to come in. At the back end, you can use a slower camera to capture whatever you want to detect. So it's a great invention, this technology that allows us to look at really short time intervals.
So why do we have to use a laser instead of just like a normal light bulb or a flashlight?
A flashlight turns on too slowly for us to observe. A laser, we can make it really short. So we use a state-of-the-art laser pulse, and that turns on within like femtosecond scale.
So the laser pulse is on the femto scale.
Right, yeah. But our camera works so fast.
Yeah, I was gonna
even
say.
Even nanoseconds feels like eternity.
Yeah, this camera makes it look like the light's just hanging out forever. It's really still on the pico scale.
Right, and you're literally watching the slowest slow motion movies right now. The hope is that our camera can be used to study some fundamental physics. We've all heard of sonar, but there's a optical counterpart of sonar called LiDAR. Very much like radar as well. You basically detect a round trip time, you know, so from the time you can measure distance.
So could that be used to see round corners?
Yes, it is feasible, although we haven't done that physically.
That's like a superpower.
Yeah. For now, we're doing something very similar to that. Let's say you have a foggy situation or a cloudy situation. To your naked eye, you will not see the airplane at all.
Okay.
So we can actually see through the cloud and get a movie like this.
You can
see this little airplane.
And I'm seeing you can also see the depth information this way.
You get depth information. This would be actually much more accurate than our eye. And this could be useful even for maybe in the future for autonomous cars. You know, we want to drive even a cloudy situation or a foggy situation, and you can see objects through the fog.
Another superpower.
And so we're also thinking about something more biological. We know that our brain is the most complex machine probably in the universe. I want to figure out how our brain computes 1 + 1 even. But using our camera, we can potentially see that.
Would this be useful for detecting damage in the brain? Like if someone's had a stroke, would you be able to see that on this?
That's certainly our hope.
Does that mean in the future, people will be able to read my mind?
That's one possibility.
I just feel like it must feel like such an accomplishment to have seen the fastest thing.
It was a surreal moment when we got the first movie at light speed
because
to observe.
Because that's the ceiling as we know it, right?
We never thought it would be possible.
Well, thank you very much, Lee Hong, for teaching us all this fascinating stuff. I'm going to be thinking about this on the way home.
I'm going to be watching this and trying to understand it several times.
All right, back to you, Gavin, Dan.
Thanks, us. This is our time cheat sheet, just a list of all the different timescales. We usually hang around milliseconds. A lot of our exposures are down to the microsecond.
Yeah.
Sometimes when we're using the 2511, we'll have exposure times that are pushing on the hundreds of nanoseconds, but that's about as far as our phantoms go.
Yeah.
We were down here with this camera and around in this ballpark.
But before, right, I kind of had it all comprehended. I had it all in my mind, like, yeah, this is the amount of time. I've lost it again now.
Well, what...
That many zeros.
What blows my mind is we had a femtosecond-long piece of light going all around.
Yeah, we did.
Filming it, you know, with picosecond differences between frames. What on earth is all this about? Yoctosecond. surely that would make the light look like you blinking. At this point, I feel like you might as well just say infinity. We've actually had a lot of comments over the years of doing this asking us to film light with our phantom, like film a torch or a laser beam or a light bulb or something. And I always have to explain to them, light is so fast that our phantom camera sees light the exact same way as our eyes do. So just for the hell of it, thought I'd demonstrate it here. Here's the light. Here's a piece of paper. Let's play it. All right, there it is. Instantly on. I just dropped that just to prove that it was in slow-mo.
Oh, yeah, nice.
Because otherwise it just looks like...
They wouldn't believe us, yeah.
They wouldn't believe us otherwise. I thought a good way to demonstrate just how fast 100 billion plus frames a second is, we could just look at some of our old footage and determine how long it would have taken at 100 billion frames a second, or 10 trillion. All right, let me pull something up. Lightning strike.
Yeah.
One of the fastest things we've ever filmed previously before we immediately beat it. If we were to film this at 100 billion frames a second, to watch the whole clip played back at 24 would take almost 4 months.
4 months?
Yeah.
And it's just happening right there.
And there it is. And if somehow we were able to film this at 10 trillion frames a second, the whole strike from beginning to end would take 32 years.
Imagine the length of that storm.
I can actually simulate exactly what that would look like if filmed at 10 trillion. Here we go. And it's playing now. That's exactly what it would look like.
Flippin' A.
All right, another clip?
No, watch the whole thing.
Okay.
32 years.
It should take us into retirement?
Yeah, I think so.
How long are you guys gonna go with this joke?
Next clip. Remember this bad lad?
I do.
Sherman round. We filmed this at 12,000 frames a second. Mm-hmm. There it is hurtling through the air. If we'd have filmed this at 100 billion frames a second, from the muzzle to when it goes out at the end of frame would take 8 years.
Well, I mean, that would kind of defeat the object of having a tank firing at something. They'd just be like, I guess I'll move out of the way.
You could serve two presidential terms before it went out of frame. Now, just for giggles, it's pretty easy math. You just add two zeros. If we filmed it at 10 trillion, 800 years from beginning to end.
So, like, quite a few Queen Elizabeths.
And finally, the human blink, specifically yours.
You can tell it's mine because of the rogue brow.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Filmed at 1,000 frames a second. If shot at 100 billion, would take 19 years for you to close and open your eyes.
Oh.
The things that you wouldn't have seen.
It'd be like, I'd be just about to celebrate the millennium. And I'd be like, whoa.
3, 2, 1.
2019?
Yeah. You blinked and missed the millennium.
Yeah.
And absurdly, if we film this at 10 trillion frames a second, the most boring video ever, it would take 1,900 years for you to open your eyes again.
So I'd just start blinking when Jesus was cutting around. Yeah. I'd open them up and it'd be World War One.
Pretty much.
Right, yeah.
That's a great way of imagining that.
Yeah.
And just think, in all that time, a few photons of light would just be like, there we go. Like it was nothing.
Yeah.
That was honestly an absurd episode. To take something that, you know, everyday time, we're used to it, but to take it to that extreme level, you could barely even get your head around. I quite liked it. I liked how much it messed with my head.
Oh, me too. I mean, I quite liked how they're telling us about the real-world applications that could be used for in the future. Like, the police might want to use it to see round corners with that LiDAR. Like the sonar where they fire light out and it bounces off all the surfaces and they see people around the corner.
Yeah, or easily being able to see through skin with one picture.
Yeah, you can see how a wound is healing, or you can like basically take an MRI with your cell phone.
It makes me slightly terrified about the future of surveillance technology, but, you know, we'll see what happens. Hopefully you enjoyed that video. Make sure you check out other episodes from Planet Slow-Mo, and you can subscribe to us, the Slow-Mo guys, if you want. The episodes aren't usually that heavy, I promise.
They guys were so smart and they wore lab coats. I feel like I should just be like,
we should take ours off.
Just take it.